Hi, everyone. I'm Tracy Michaud. I'm an assistant professor of tourism and hospitality at the University of Southern Maine in Portland, Maine, and at Reykjavik University in Reykjavik, Iceland. I'm an applied anthropologist, and I teach in a school of public service and in a school of business. And so I'm here to talk about applied anthropology and how I have put it to use studying and working on projects in sustainable tourism development in rural areas in the North Atlantic. So, what is applied anthropology? Well, a quick Google search of applied anthropology will give results like these. The application of the methods and theory of anthropology, or the scientific study of humanity, to the analysis and solution of practical problems. A broad array of research, methods, and outcomes for the explicit purpose of recognizing, understanding, and addressing human problems. Aspects of anthropology, which is the study of human societies and cultures through time, that serves practical community and organizational needs. So simply put, it is anthropology put to use. As an applied anthropologist, the practical problem that I care about is, how do we do sustainable and responsible tourism development and management in rural regions, especially in places where rapid tourism increases, such as the North Atlantic and Arctic, can have long-lasting impacts, can be potentially good or potentially bad, depending on how the development and management goes. In my work, I focus on humans, the cultures, the communities that are in the process of creating sustainable and responsible tourism. And I work with these communities and people to find solutions that are good for the environment, economy, and society. I try to give voice to stakeholders and communities and make sure that tourism benefits local quality of life. And I partner with economic and community development, nonprofit organizations and NGOs, tourism management entities, educational institutions, and governments to do this work. So I use traditional methods of anthropological inquiry, ethnography, community forums, interviews. For instance, I work up in the Maine Highlands with economic development organizations there, doing some tourism branding and also coming up with strategies for growing the economy based on the heritage, culture, and quality of life there. We used art to engage communities in conversations around what the place meant to them. And as you can see, a lot of connection to the natural world, trees, mountains, rivers, lakes, wildlife. And this helped inform a brand that the region could identify with and get behind and support the Maine Highlands, which has that natural element in there. We also brought in ethnographers and ethnomusicologists to spend some time talking about some of the history of the area with local people and their connection to traditional crafts. We see here a gentleman in the region demonstrating how to make wood and hide snowshoes, which he was still continuing this tradition. There was many people we found where these traditional skills were allowing them to earn a little bit of extra income, as well as keeping these art forms going. And from this, we created the Center for Maine Craft, which was a place that tourists could see and buy this work, as well as learn about it and get information on how to connect with these traditional craft artists throughout Maine, as a way to build on the traditions that were still being kept going and help them earn revenue at it, a positive sustainable development strategy. Also up in Iceland, worked at the Geldingadalur volcano, which was a new volcano that started erupting in March of 2021. As of November 2021, it looks like those eruptions have stopped, but it hasn't stopped people from flocking there and visiting it. So these are some images here of visitors at the volcano when it was erupting, walking near the lava flows that occurred. It was a place that was accessible to people. And so many, many hundreds of thousands of people probably at this point have visited there. And questions of how to manage this site came up with local stakeholders. Who is responsible for creating the pathways, maintaining it, the signage that keeps people safe? Who can charge money here? There's a tradition of people being able to access natural sites on private property. That's actually part of the culture there, as well as codified into policy. And so how does that affect the management of a site that potentially could be dangerous to people? So a master's student at Reykjavik University looked at how this process of figuring out how to manage this emergent tourist site was going according to perceptions of local stakeholders, because understanding local community perceptions, as well as the landowners and other government officials that were involved in that, can help with making sure the process is one that is as positive as possible, that includes many voices, and ultimately can create a sustainable strategy moving forward. So these are some of the traditional methods through interviews, community forum, ethnography, that applied anthropologists can put toward distinct practical problems. So I also use new methods, digital ethnography. It's essentially the aspects of traditional ethnography, except that you gain the data through the digital universe. So I've worked in Greenland looking at social media images of Greenland in order to help inform on a local voice in tourism development. For instance, we pulled Flickr photos, social media site photos from Greenland from 2004 to 2020. On the left are the densities of photos from local people from Greenland, and on the right are the density of photos from visitors. As you can see, the visitors by far dominate the imagery on the Flickr social media site, and hence as a proxy for likely social media in general. And so it's a reminder that knowing the strength of social media to influence how a site is perceived, and also even a sense of place of locals based on imagery, that the local voice is really missing in this and needs to be a part of any conversations of how tourism development happens and the imagery of Greenland around that. Also, Maine social media images we've used to look at tourism changing travel patterns and the COVID-19 pandemic. And essentially what we found are visitors that came from unrestricted states during the pandemic, so those states that didn't have any travel restrictions on them, ended up moving more inland and north, in particular high densities. And those that came from places with restrictions also move north, but much more into the rural inland areas and much more dispersed. And with that, we could analyze different restriction policies, take a look at the economic opportunities that might come from people shifting into areas that might not have had much tourism in the past, but would like to have tourism, and the potential issues that that might pose for communities. And so this new type of data, looking at how to pull information, social information, cultural information from the digital universe can be very helpful, especially during times like this, during a pandemic, when this video was recorded, where it's very hard to get in-person data. You can access a lot of data through the internet and through digital means, and we can use it to inform on traditional anthropological inquiries around people, communities, culture, and the global world that we live in. With that, I will say thanks for listening, and Best wishes in your pursuits of applied anthropology.